See, I think the South Bronx suffered more from that blackout than any other four boroughs.
We've been needlessly subjected to a night of terror in many communities that have been wantonly looted and burned.
I don't think anything was special. It was home. It was home. I mean, people had their own negative version of what they thought the Bronx was. The Bronx was burning. The Bronx was going to this. The Bronx had economic, social problems and this and that. That was home for me.
There was really nothing to do here. We only had like one movie theater, which was over there, which is deteriorated. We had one movie theater that came apart. We didn't have a lot of opportunities to come out about us in the South Bronx. That's what it was.
Unable to go to Studio 54 and lacking any local club scene, young people took matters into their own hands.
It started with the emphasizing of music education in the school systems. And since so many things were taken away from the community sort of like culturally compensated for that with the creation of making something out of things that just happened to be around. Old turntables, old record collections, hooking systems up into street poles for wiring, making art out of a wall and a spray can that happened to be left to the side, being able to dance on some cardboard.
Open-air disco parties sprung up on the streets and in the parks of the South Bronx, and the DJs who hosted them became neighborhood stars. One of the first to get a reputation for doing something different was DJ Kool Herc.
I was a guy that never went downtown. I stayed in the neighborhood and formed a culture called hip-hop. I was the guy that didn't follow with the rest of the people.
Well, basically, Kool Herc was the guy who got two turntables and a system, came out in a big park, and he rocked the park, you know what I'm saying?
It wasn't called hip-hop when I was doing it. It was called a jam. Coming to the jam.
But the thing about Kool Herc, he played a lot of stuff. Like, he was a DJ who played records that you never hear on the radio. That's what he was. You know what I'm saying? A lot of break beats, a lot of hot break beats and all that.
Breakbeat was a term used for old funk records where the music broke down to a bare rhythm. Herc would take instrumental breaks from different records and mix them together non-stop. Other DJs soon picked up on the technique.
I figured out, like, to every great song there's a great part. And a lot of times, you know, that part could have been 10 seconds. That really used to piss me off. Like, you know, best part of the record is when the drummer finally gets a moment and the rest of the band members is just taking a coffee break. So why can't this be 5 minutes? So I had to figure out a way to take this particular passage of the record, repeat that, but also add percussive noises and repeat it and sort of like do some manual editing to it. Kind of like do things to the record that the record just kind of like just should have had.
Class scientist goes to high school and wants to build technical things and makes a mixer and stuff like that. And once again, it was one of those understatements of inner city black children, Hispanic children that they're saying, you know, we got our geniuses and people want to have the quest to become smarter and have opportunities to do great things. And the city was basically saying, no, nigga, you're not going to be anything more than just a, you know, a little slum creature. And the minds and the spirits and the souls came up through hip-hop, said, no, we want to be bigger and better than that.
Hip-hop was that thing that everybody at these particular kind of parties that got on the mic at some point would say to the hip, the hop, the hippie, dippy, 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 hip, hip, hop, you don't stop. And that's how you would define one of those parties as opposed to one of the disco parties.
These parties were an outlet for a lot of aggressive energy that was bottled up otherwise. It's a place where guys who were criminals, who wanted to prey on people who looked like them, could go. What better place to rob someone that a room full of guys wearing the same snorkel and the same baseball cap.
The violence came from members of organized gangs whose territorial wars were a major problem in the Bronx.
1975, 76, 77, this park right here was most famous for gang activity. This is the park where if you got into a situation with the gangs, they probably bring you here to set you off right here because it's real big, it's like Central Park. So if they was gonna murder you or beat you up or anything or take your stuff, they would bring you in here because it take a long time for the cops to find you in St. Mary's Park. You know what I'm saying? So most of the gangs, like the Bachelors, the Backspades, the Savage Nomads, they used to have their little gang fights right here in this park right here.
But one man would see the light. Afrika Bambaataa was a committed gang member until a close friend was shot dead by the NYPD. Inspired by Kool Herc, Bambaataa turned to DJing at block parties in an effort to end gang warfare.
Yes, I was part of a great street gang and many other street gangs that I've been involved with. My greatest one was the Black Spades, Savage Spades.
There was a lot of pain, a lot of distress going on in the Bronx, you know, with the gang thing that was going on. He took, like, a huge mass of people that were so angry, and he turned that nervous energy into this coalition that's now worldwide.
You still got the Savage Nomads, the Seven Immortals, and all them people out here. Same thing, you know. The only thing is that they do all that crazy shit, man, dancing and all that, man. You know, like they be showing on TV, right? Instead of fighting, they go out there and dance each other to death, right? Which is better than going out there with a 30-30 and shoot somebody in the head, right?
The gang culture started fading away to the hip-hop culture. Then you started getting crews and organizations. Thus came, you know, the birth. We had the Bronx River Organization that became the organization. From the organization became the Zulu Nation. From the Zulu Nation became the Almighty Zulu Nation. And from the Almighty Zulu Nation became the Universal Zulu Nation.
Bambaataa had the wherewithal to say, you know, music to kind of like, you know, calm the savage beast and kind of like make people just say, forget the drama and the beef. Let's kind of like, you know, have a time at this because we're kind of all here together.
Is everybody in the house?
As the nascent hip-hop scene absorbed the street gang's energy, it began to flourish and the word spread across town. Subway trains tagged up in the Bronx's vast train yards took graffiti, hip-hop's visual message, right into the heart of Manhattan. The New York art world was quick to see the potential in graffiti, and it was soon feted as the freshest thing since Warhol. Graffiti artists like Fab Five Freddy became hip-hop's ambassadors for those curious to find out more, such as Blondie.
Well, I kind of turned them on to hip-hop, took them to the Bronx, showed them hip-hop in the raw, in the flesh, and they kind of took me with them to parties, introduced me to Warhol, and I met kind of like that, you know, the cream of the downtown art scene.
Of all the downtown bands, Blondie had had the most success. These so-called punks had even hit number one with a disco song, Heart of Glass. And having assimilated one New York musical form, Blondie were keen to sample another.
Fab Five Freddy used to always come to my parties up in the Bronx, and he had always said to us, man, I'm gonna bring Blondie up here. We all personally thought he was full of shit, you know, because at that time she had called me, she had all these pew songs in my ear, right, you know.
Well, in 77, Freddie brought us up to the South Bronx to this big hip-hop event that had already been in full swing, and it really parallels the downtown rock scene. And I just called it a destructivist, reconstructionist form where they're pulling things apart and putting it back together again, taking the records and doing the scratching and all that stuff. Similar to us pulling apart the old forms of rock and roll and putting them back together again.
The majority of my audience was, you know, blacks, Spanish, Latinos, and there was this one blonde head coming through the crowd, you know, and Freddie was in front of her, and she came, and she says, you know something, I sat there and I watched you, and it was so amazing watching you play on the turntables. She says, I'm going to write a song about you. And of course, I gave her a smile, like, yeah, right.
And I guess their way of helping was they made this record called Rapture, which mentioned me on the record. They said, Fab Five Freddy told me everybody's fly. There's a DJ named Flash, and he's the fastest. And
Fab Five Freddy told me everybody's fly. DJ is spinning, I said, my. Flash is fast, Flash is cool. Francois, c'est pas, Flash ain't no Duke. And jump start, shoot shot.
You know, and Debbie just took all that stuff and just kind of spit it out in the rap that she did for Rapture, which was probably the first time most people heard this idea of rapping. Like, what is this? It was a huge record.
And eat your head, and then you're in the man from Mars. You go out at night, eating cars, you eat Cadillacs, Lincolns too, Mercury's and Subaru, and don't stop, you keep...
Yeah, but Rapture is really an homage. It wasn't intended as an actual rap song, but... Still, the guys from Wu-Tang told me it was the first rap song he ever heard, so that's like kind of a mind fuck, you know.
Rapture's blend of New York influences went far beyond the five boroughs, reaching the American number one spot in 81. The song took hip-hop out of New York and into the wider world, where it would become today's biggest selling genre. The song stood at the pinnacle of a golden era of street music in which New York's urban neighborhoods gave birth to hip-hop, disco, and punk.
Some element of the hardcore of survivors in a frontier town. The fact that you could walk two blocks in either direction and be in an entirely different musical world. It was a great place to be creative and to realize that you were beyond a sense of rule.
Just think about this. We're talking about people going into a park, a city schoolyard or a park, with huge speakers and, you know, dancers blasting music. That would never happen now. It's a quality of life crime.
Manhattan has really fucked itself, shot itself in the foot by making it impossible for young people to move here. It's really, really hard to move into New York these days. So that's really created quite a big difference.
And there's no place today for the last remaining symbol of 70s New York, CBGB, which shut its doors for the last time in October 2006.
You know, I mean, they could have, like, built around the church, they could have put the condos, and, I mean, all the new hip gentry that's coming to the fucking area would have been happy to live in a very expensive condo over the CBGB's museum.
What's happening to New York? Look around. Try to get an apartment.
Push me, cause I'm close to the edge. I'm trying not to lose my head.
These days, New York is safe, clean, and rich. But the golden era of street music, of making something out of nothing, seems to have gone forever.
Crazy lady living in a bag, eating out of garbage pails, used to be a fag hag, such a nasty tango, skip the life and dang.
As part of 1997 week, don't miss I Love 1997 on Tuesday evening at 7.
She went to the city and got so did it. She had to get a push, she couldn't make it on her own. Don't push me, cause I'm close to the edge. I'm trying not to...